this thing I'll give up. Everybody knows where it started. It started in China. The rest of it, about whether it's a lab virus, whether it started in the wet markets, that is still, we don't know anything about it. Though the lab virus part of it is dubious as of now, because the scientists have established that there is no such genetic alteration which has been done to the virus so far. I mean, whatever evidence is available as of present time, that it does not appear to be anything which has been manufactured with the malignant intent to harm other people in a lab. The other part of it, people are saying that it has come out of a lab by accident and they were experimenting on this virus out there. Now, that's a fact that that Wuhan lab was working on this virus. I mean, not on this virus, on viruses originating in bats, because they started this program way back after SARS, that was in 2009. So exactly that part of it also, there's a lot of rumors, a lot of stuff going around, but so far nothing is established. Forget about all that, where it originated. The fact remains that it did probably originate in China. And thereafter, yes, there has been definitely a certain amount of information which has not been shared by China with the rest of the world. That is obvious to everybody. So probably we did not get the kind of head start, or people were not sufficiently alarmed about it to take precautions in time. That is the general consensus. All right, that's much we do know, that yes, we could have got more information, which we would have got a little more time to prepare, and we could have probably been, the seriousness of the situation probably did not come across to everybody. To most world governments, they were not sufficiently serious about it. So that said, the virus is basically a coronavirus. A similar virus was there, which was the SARS outbreak in 2009, that also started from from China. And if you look it up, actually, the SARS epidemic also did do a lot of havoc in mostly European countries and also in Southeast Asia. Go through the fact that during SARS also, it did affect a lot of the world at that point of time. Officially, the death toll was, it varies from different reports coming in, but there is some unsubstantiated rumors which says that nearly 1.5 lakh people, 150,000 people died across the world from that also. So it's not that we've not had a pandemic in the recent past. It was there in 2009, carried on till 2010, when WHO officially announced that it was over. But the difference was that at that point of time, WHO issued a warning very fast, in the sense like they probably got correct information or they were more proactive. So people took precautions in time. This is as far as the introduction of the virus goes. Basically, that is the reason why WHO is being criticized now. Now, they claim that they did not get information in time, or they did the best they could, but let's leave that aside. Let's go on to what the virus does to your body. It primarily is an airborne virus, which means it enters your body through your nose, through your mouth, and also through fluids like your eyes. This is the primary mode of getting into your body. Like if you touch a surface which has the virus, and then let us say you put it into your mouth. Okay, then mouth per se, if it goes into your digestive tract, it is not supposed to do much. But since you also breathe through your mouth, you breathe through your nose, and yes, the virus dissolves in your fluids in your eyes. So these are the three portals of entry: your nose, your eyes, and your mouth. So it does not enter through your skin. It does not enter through the food that you eat. So these are the things we have to be a little aware of. And since a person, when he speaks, like I'm speaking now, there's an aerosol which is generated from my mouth, which travels up to 3 feet. That is why people are saying that you should stay at a distance of 3 feet from that person. That's the first part of it. The second part of it, since there is, WHO has confirmed this, that the aerosol that comes out of the mouth, it travels till 3 feet, but it stays in the air for a period of time. And because of normal wind movement within the room, it can travel up to 6 feet. So many places in Europe, including United Kingdom, have suggested that social distancing should ideally be 2 meters or 6 feet. See, up to now, what has been happening for people, not just for doctors, but for everybody, is the basic fear of the virus. Like what, how it gets into us, what, and if you gets into you also. The thing is that we should know one fact, that by and large, the younger population has not been affected very badly. Very few people among the younger lot have actually had any serious complications from the disease, and very few have died. Some do die. Now, the reason for that, people are saying, is because of the viral load. Like, I'll give an example. Like, suppose you're working in a closed environment with patients, for example, let us say in an ICU setting. There, since there are multiple patients of COVID are there, and obviously they're all breathing out there, and doctors are coming repeatedly in contact with those people. So there's a theory which says that the amount of virus which that doctor or the healthcare worker or the sanitation worker or anybody who's in close contact, since he's keeping on ingesting the virus in the immediate atmosphere or in the immediate air around him, that is making a difference. Whereas a person traveling in a lift, for example, if someone has used a lift earlier also, there would not be so much of virus particles in the air. So a person who gets infected in a lift is likely to have a less serious form of illness than a person who's exposed to an area where which has got much more number of virus particles in the air. The whole, it's like this. Since out of, let's say, 100 people are there, as of now, whatever we know, let's say even the number of people who get infected, even if it is, let's say, 100%, we know that 80% of them roughly across the world are going to be asymptomatic. So that leaves you with 20 people who are symptomatic.
Can you define what asymptomatic?
Asymptomatic means the person has got infected with the virus. He is possibly a carrier. Once he gets infected, obviously the virus is there inside the body. So he can infect others. But since he's one young, possibly his immunity is good. Number three, he does not have any comorbidities like diabetes, hypertension, or heart disease. So he does not manifest the disease. I mean, the disease doesn't do anything. The virus being in the body does not do any harm to it. It's like 80% of the people are getting infected. And this is a by and large across the globe, if you check it out, this is how it is happening. So 20% of the people who are getting infected, and let us assume everybody will get infected, 20% will manifest the disease. And out of the 20%, out of 100% of the people who get infected, I mean, the WHO figure says about 3 to 4 people are going to have very severe disease. I mean, sorry, more than that will get 10 to 12 people will get severe disease, and 3 to 4% will die from it. But if you translate it like from a 100% infectivity, which is not happening as of now, so the number of deaths are actually something close to less than 1% or even 0.1 to 0.2%. So there's a lot of hype about the virus, which is scaring a lot of people, but it is not as scary as, like, if you get it, you will die. That's the kind of thing which people are scared of. What people will have to do right now, I mean, if you can avoid getting the virus, then why the hell should we get infected? But like, I liked your point, what you said. We are probably going to have much more economic issues, and you know it, Harish, much better than I do, that how many people are dying of other issues is way much more than what is going to die from this. People are going to die from this virus also, even if it hits us badly, which it still so far doesn't appear to have hit us badly, for we don't know the reasons. Like, I'd put it on, I mean, we know, like, maybe the heat, maybe the BCG vaccine, maybe the OPV, we're guessing, or is probably we are at the beginning of the curve, so we are not manifesting the kind of deaths or severe infections which we are seeing in other countries like in US. All right. But we must know one particular thing, that in USA, New York reported that ultimately a person who is getting sick and if he has comorbidities, 88% of people who are going on to ventilators are dying. I'm just telling this in perspective, like out of 100 people who are going on ventilators, 88 people are dying out of that. And you want to pump in a lot of money on ventilators and other stuff, and not give food to people who really require food, people are going to die. Many more people are going to die of starvation. Mm-hmm. And I like that point of yours, and it makes absolute sense. Number one. So one, yes, fair enough. We need to take basic precautions to avoid getting the virus at this point of time. The lockdown is helping to probably, it is helping to spread the virus. That is a known fact. I mean, less people are getting infected, and we are kind of hoping that over a period of time, the infected people will be isolated, so it will not spread to more of the population. But sooner or later, we'll have to lift the lockdown. And this is going to be there in the community, not for some days or weeks. It's going to stay for months right now. So some basic precautions we'll have to take over the next few months. One is probably masks will become part of our culture. We will have to use masks. And again, masks have to be used sensibly. Like if you're using a single-use mask, like the surgical mask, that should be used just once. if you've got a good mask, like it's a cloth mask, you can probably wash it. If you're going into a very high, into like your people work, Harish, I know a lot of them in people where they're helping out in social programs. If they don't have very good N95 masks, which are in shortage, then maybe they can use a single use, 10 bucks. They cost even cheaper if you buy them in bulk. They come for 5 rupees. Use a blue mask inside and over that wear a cloth mask. That will give you some additional protection. Secondly, obviously, eye covers, some kind of goggles, which are very cheap. They're available in bulk for about 50 bucks. And that can be washed with soap and water or with sodium hypochlorite or just kept in the sun for 4 days. That's good enough. And gloves, since you'll be moving around. And gloves are a double-edged weapon because if you're wearing gloves, you'll have to be very cautious about not touching your face while you're wearing it. So these are the precautions we'll have to take for quite some time to come, especially people who are working with underprivileged people, because it is going to spread there more. I'll tell you two things which we are now noticing. One is that the people who are getting infected are mostly coming in from places like grocery shops, vegetable vendors, because the vegetable vendors, like in Delhi, I can give you the Delhi scenario. The vegetable vendors pick up the medicines from a Azadpur, let us say, sabji mandi. Now, unfortunately, there is a lot of people are around. So we really don't know where the vegetable, this I'm talking of the cart or the thelawalas, right? So they are going there in bulk and they're picking up the vegetables and then they're selling it in carts. So there, from there, we are getting people who are getting infected and from shops. So ideally, if you will have to buy groceries, you will have to buy vegetables. But I would advise you that if you can limit the number of times you go to them. A small example, like when you're going to pick up from a vegetable vendor in particular, from a thelawala, because they are the ones who are mostly operating now. If possible, you would be taking your own bags, I suppose. When you get the vegetables from that one, though, for 110% wear a mask and eye glasses when you go to them. Number two, when you pick up the supplies, please either wash them. You can, they say potassium permanganate solution. It's difficult. I'm not going to explain that. Everyone can't get hold of it. But even a little bit of water with maybe a pinch of soap, not too much of it, rinse it out well in that, leave it to dry before using them. Because he would have used it, there would be his mouth secretions which would have fallen on those roots, and he himself would be possibly a source of contagion. So buy up in bulk, maybe for a week, 7-8 days, and the similar stuff for groceries are also. The only idea is that the minimum number of times you go out and interact with such people, the chances of your interacting or with a person who's COVID positive becomes less. The point I want to make on medicines, you know, all of us have got either health issues or a parents, especially elderly people or children, who are on regular medication. Like in my family, all three of us on regular medication. Now, I'll tell you one thing. Now, a lot of spurious medicines are flooding the market. Like if a diabetic, for example, uses a glycyphage tablet. Now, unfortunately, whatever the stocks people have, they're slowly running out in shops. And even the suppliers, a lot of suppliers are stranded in trucks across the country. They're exposed to a lot of heat. So a lot of the medicines do require a certain amount of, if not cold chain, they require to be preserved under 25 degrees or 30 degrees or 35 degrees temperature. Now, in these trucks, which the medicines are being carried from the warehouses to the, dealers and to the shops thereafter, the medicines are likely to become, to degrade a bit. So they will become less useful. So I'm asking secondly, the supply chain, if it gets affected in the sense like raw material supply chain, then the spurious market medicines are going to take over. So those who are taking regular medicines, please ask them to make sure they've got adequate stocks for 3 months. It does sound like hoarding, but this is something you can't compromise. Like I take insulin, for example. I've gotten at least insulin stores for myself for the next 3 months. Things like whenever you go out of the house, we know that all of us will wear masks. I will request you to wear a head cover. I told this earlier also. One is a head cover because the hair is something which most ladies do not wash when on a regular basis or on a daily basis, right? Because they're scared the hair gets spoiled, and which is a fact also. If you use too much of detergent or shampoos and soap in your hair, the hair tends to lose its natural oils. So in such circumstances, since we don't generally scrub a hair with soap or a detergent, it makes sense to have a head cover, some kind of eye shades, a mask. And if it is feasible, to wear gloves also. These are the four things. Now, when you come back inside the house, keep your shoes outside. You do not need to bring your shoes inside. Nobody is going to pick up a pair of shoes in today's days. Please keep your shoes outside, because 50% of the infections which is carried into the house comes in from your shoes. And that has been established for coronavirus also. Thereafter, if your outer clothing, if you can wear an outer clothing over your normal clothes, then just dump, put a bucket of soap and water near your door, put the outer covering, or you can do that in your bathroom, go straight to your bathroom, pick off all your clothes, put it in a soap and water solution, and contact period should not be less than half an hour. I mean, just don't dip it and take it out and wash it. Let it be for at least half an hour, soak it, and thereafter you can either wash it manually or you can put it in a washing machine separately from other clothes. Now, see, this is a typical PPE kit. This, I won't show it, but like, it's huge for you all. And this is something which you'll be seeing a lot of people wearing, right? This is the cover. I mean, I don't know if it's visible. Maybe it's too white. Okay, you don't need this for an average person. But those of your people who are going out to work in, let us say, underprivileged areas where people are going to mix around with a lot of people, I would recommend buy this. This is actually reusable, though it's not recommended for reuse. But what I'm doing, I'm reusable. All right. It doesn't cost much. A whole set comes for about $650. Now, this is something which I want you all to do. Those people who are going out to work with places, like besides an eye shield. This is an eye shield, but see, this is an eye shield which doesn't cover your face really. Like, I'll put it on, I'll show it to you. It leaves too much of gaps, like over from the sides, from below. So what I would prefer, that if you don't get a proper eye shield, which I managed to get some, like this is a face shield. Well, it's still in its packing. This is like comes and covers your face completely. This also, if you can't get hold of, this is nothing, but I've taken this from my scooter helmet. All right. This is this protects your face, as in it gives you protection from here till you're below your nose. So any aerosol, anything, anyone in contact with you from even 2 meters distance will protect you. This is for your workers. I mean, these people who are actually working in the field, I'm probably digressing from what we are speaking of. But I'll set a list to you separately, so I don't think we need to talk on this now. Okay, as far as your personal hygiene is concerned, when you enter the house, since you all will not, I've already told you, cap, mask, gloves, and your face mask. Now, other than that, inside your own house, like if you can, clean up the house once a day or even once in 2 days with normal Lysol, that is adequate. You don't need to do anything more than that. Lysol, any disinfectant inside the house. This way, your daily personal cleaning, which all of us do. So I don't think that's an issue for most of us in India, at least. One small thing which we found is helping patients, like a lot of people, especially elderly or people who have got less access to green vegetables and all, I would recommend just pop one B-complex capsule or a tablet every day. It does boost your immunity because it has got a lot of micronutrients, and basically what you get from your vegetables is minerals and vitamins. The calorie content is negligible, and in any case, the calorie, except for potatoes and vegetables like that, and you will get calorie content from your rice, dal, chawal and all. So I will recommend one B-complex capsules for people who are elderly and for children who are not taking adequate green vegetables for this period of time, maybe 15 capsules in a month or even 10 capsules in a month, maybe one every alternate day, one every third day. It is kind of helping. We have been giving it in our OPD setup. And so far, we've been lucky. We've only had 7 cases of tested positive. And of course, positive people are treated separately. But we are giving it out routinely. We don't know whether it's well. It's a myth as of now. See, if you have a normal cough and cold with paracetamol and with cough syrup, and if possibly an antibiotic, which on telemedicine, they can consult somebody and take also, like a very basic antibiotic, let's say amoxicillin, okay, 500 mg 3 times a day. It should clear up in 3 to 4 days. But if it is not going, if it is going beyond 7 days, then it may be COVID. So it makes sense to test mental health. Now, right. That's a fact. What's happening, a lot of elderly people, okay, they're cooped up in the houses. Now, the only place they can come to, come out, if they say that we have to go to a hospital, last 2 weeks, we're getting a lot of people who are coming in with very vague symptoms and signs. And when we ask them, why did you come out in this kind of point of time? So they're saying, like doctor sahab, hum log ghar mein baithe baithe, like sitting at home, we have got absolutely going out of our minds, and this is the only way we can go out. All right, so this is taking a toll on people who are trapped indoors. They can't even take a proper walk outside. So in this time, I guess people are mostly staying with their own families. So they have to devise their own mechanisms to keep children in particular. Children, I'm talking of the people in senior school, especially in that, because I have a daughter who is now preparing for her engineering entrances. So they're getting cooped up in one place. So families need to devise some means in which they take time out for elderly people, take time out for children in particular, so they are occupied and they feel part of a family.